Good evening. Thank you for joining us for Trinity United Methodist Church's Good Friday service. I'm Pastor Leslie Stevens. Our liturgy that we're going to use tonight is from Reverend Richard and Charlene Fairchild, and so I thank them for their contribution to our service this evening. We begin our time together with a scripture reading from the book of Luke, chapter 23, verses 33 through 34.
When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed Jesus to the cross there, and the two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing."
They do not know what they are doing. They do not know? They who killed Jesus? How could they not know? And who is they? It is so easy to name others, to blame others, the Romans, the crowds, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas, they all played their parts. They conspired. Some of them just simply followed orders to maintain the peace, to keep Jesus' kingdom from infringing on theirs. And yet, where are we when Jesus' kingdom infringes on ours, on our peace, on our order, on our prosperity and our security? Where are we when the victims of our peace cry for justice? When those disenfranchised by our order call for compassion? When the hungry and the lonely beg us to share our prosperity, our security, our power? Where are we when Christ is crucified among us? Surely he should have raged at those who nailed him to the tree. Surely he should have raged at us for the evil that we do, the evil we do knowingly and unknowingly. Yet his compassion is there in the first words. He intercedes with us to the Father. It is that same compassion that called him to his mother's womb, that compassion that held him to the cross, that compassion that brings incredible and unbelievable grace. Compassion that has echoed through the centuries to all of us who participate in the killing of Christ. It is a compassion that cries out from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Lord, were you there?
Our next scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Luke in the 23rd chapter. One of the criminals hanging there threw insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." The other one, however, rebuked him, saying, "Don't you fear God? Here we are, all under the same sentence. Ours, however, is only right, for we are getting what we deserve for what we did. But he has done no wrong." And he said to Jesus, "Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king." And Jesus said to him, "I tell you this, today you will be with me in paradise."
How much are we like the first thief? Full of anger because we are not rescued from our sin. Full of hate because we suffer because of the sins of others. How much do we want God to snap his fingers and make everything right that we have made wrong? What we have allowed others to make wrong. How easy is it for us to cry, "Save us," and to rail against God because there is no magic cure, no miraculous recovery, no legion of angels to take away pain and to bring wholeness. How easy is it to scorn the Messiah, to mock the goodness of the world and condemn the light of the world because we are unwilling to face what we have done. Yet there is goodness. There is a cure for sin, a cure that doesn't promise magical solutions, but promises that the pain of sin is not the end. That when all this is over, when all of the suffering is finished, that the final word is not torture and defeat, but life. Life springing forth from the ashes. Life transformed and fulfilled in paradise. To the compassionate thief, to the one who could still recognize the good in the world, to the one who showed compassion to Jesus, who tried to comfort and protect the good, to the one who sought good, comfort was given. Today, you will be with me in paradise.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we may be made whole. In John's gospel, it says, standing close to Jesus' cross, where his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene, Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there. So he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time, the disciple took her to live in his home.
Who can grasp the grief? The grief of Mary watching her son suffer. The grief of Mary watching him die. And who can grasp the grief of the son who must see his mother crying? What gift can a man give to his mother? What can he offer when he is gone? How can he help her, comfort her, hold her, honor her? "Woman, here is your son. Here is the one that I love. To love you and for you to love, one who is my brother and can speak of me, one who can hold you and comfort you and honor you, one who shares your grief. Here is your mother. Here is the one that I love, for you to love and to love you, the one who taught me, the one who fed me, the one who hugged me and held me, who wiped away my tears, and the one who grieves with you. Woman, behold your children, and children, behold your mother."
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole. The Gospel of Mark tells us that when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?"
Of all the agony of that torturous day, the lacerations, the chafing of the thorns around his head, the convulsions of his tormented, dehydrated body as it hung in the heat of the day, nothing reaches the depth of the anguished cry of desolation. My God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus, who found his purpose and strength in the presence of God, who was sustained by the immediacy of his relationship with God, and who endured all by the tangible power of God always at work within him, always a center of vitality and peace, felt that he was totally alone on the cross. Jesus, whose very being was God, found himself utterly, absolutely, despairingly cut off from all that life and breath gives, cut off from all that gave him purpose and hope, cut off from the source of his being, cut off even from himself, plunging into the depths of the human condition to walk in the place of the utter absence of God, in the place of sinners, in the place of those who reject God. My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" In these words is the central mystery of the crucifixion, which cannot be fully comprehended, that there is no despair so deep, or evil so overwhelming, or place so far removed from joy and light and love from the very heart of God, that God has not been before us, and where God cannot meet us and bring us home.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Sin to hide,
The Gospel of John tells us that after this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst."
There is a kind of timelessness about death on a cross. It's not a quiet death, over in an instant, in one glorious moment of martyrdom, like being torn apart by a lion. A cross is as much an instrument of torture as it is a gallows from which to hang. And as the days wear on, seconds stretch into minutes, which stretch into hours, until there comes a point when time can no longer be measured except in the gradual weakening of the body and its ever more insistent demands for that substance which is so vital to life, so foundational to all living things, so basic to life as we know it, water. Water to moisten a parched mouth, water to free a swollen tongue, water to open a rasping throat that cannot gasp for air, water to keep hope alive, to keep life alive for just a few moments longer. Water to a crucified man is life. O God, thou art my God, I seek thee. My soul thirsts for thee. My flesh faints for thee, is in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Who can tell if these words from Psalm 63 went through Jesus's mind? But a thirst for water is a thirst for life, and a thirst for life is a thirst for God. God who promises streams in the desert, mighty rivers in the dry land, and living water to wash away every tear. Here at the end of it all, these promises seem far away and distant. And yet Jesus, who felt forsaken by God, still clings to the memory and the hope of life. I thirst.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole. Scripture tells us that a bowl was there full of cheap wine mixed with vinegar. So a sponge was soaked in it, put on stalks of hyssop, and lifted up to his lips. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished."
What a sigh of relief. What a cry of deliverance that finally, after seemingly endless pain and gasping torment, it is over at last. The suffering is ended. The ordeal is finished. And nothing remains but the blessed absence of all sensation. What a moment of peace. When all there is pain, its ceasing to be is the greatest blessing of all, even when its ceasing only comes with death. Many of you have experienced that with those that you love. But Jesus' cry is more than just welcoming the ending of pain. It is more than joy at the deliverance that death brings. He does not merely say it is over. He says it is accomplished, fulfilled, achieved. Jesus' cry isn't of defeat and despair. It is a cry of success and triumph. Even at the moment of death, that the race has been run, that he has endured to the end, that the strife is over and the battle is won. Jesus' cry is a cry of relief, to be sure, but it is also a cry of victory. The work I came to do is complete. There is nothing more to add. It is finished.
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole. The Gospel of Luke in the 23rd chapter says, "Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, 'Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit.' And having said this, he breathed his last."
It is the end. It is the very end. The end of the ordeal. The end of the suffering. And Jesus, alone on the cross, tortured, exhausted, abandoned by his friends, feeling absent from God, gasps for a last breath and gathers the strength for one final cry. Why would he choose to speak so close to the end? Why would he muster that last energy he had to cry out with a loud voice? Couldn't God have just heard his thoughts? Unless God wasn't the only one intended to hear. Unless his voice was pitched loud so that we too might hear that his final dedication of his soul was a dedication made despite the pain, despite the mocking, despite the agony, despite the sense of horrible aloneness that he felt. A dedication made to God before the resurrection, before the victory of the kingdom, before any assurance other than what faith could bring. Jesus entrusts his spirit, his life, and all that has given it meaning to God in faith, even at the point of his own abandonment, when the good seems so very far away. He proclaims in faith to God, "The darkness cannot overcome it. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us. You suffered and died that we might be made whole.